Most mass burn plants will have a similar layout and inputs and outputs as what's summarized on the screen for you here. So coming in the door, we've got our waste. We're also bringing a lot of aeration for our reaction, which is characterized by excess oxygen. And then coming out of the plant, we have all sorts of things. So we've got our energy being recovered as electricity and or heat. We've got our flue gases that are coming up our stack, and we're gonna do a whole bunch of work to clean those up before they go out into the environment, as we'll touch on in following videos. We've got our bottom ash that's coming out of the combustion part of the reaction directly. So all that heavy stuff that hasn't been burned, and it's got all that ash fraction and metals and things like that. And then we've got our fly ash, which is actually moving away from the waste in our flue gas, but we're capturing it through our air pollution control system. And that fly ash, because it's in with the flue gas, it'll tend to absorb a lot of the toxic things that are in the flue gas and makes it a more hazardous material to handle than the bottom ash. As you step through the previous video, you would have seen all these steps. So as the waste comes in, there's a step where it's dropped off into a big bunker. It's stored and mixed. It's loaded into the combustion chamber itself. There's the actual combustion reaction. There's energy recovery with all the hot flue gases coming off the combustion. Then all the flue gases pass through air pollution control. And then as that's happening, all the ash coming out of the air pollution control system, as well as the bottom ash coming out of the combustion chamber, are being managed through ash management systems. So what does each of those look like? The drop-off step will look similar to other waste facilities like transfer stations and AD tip floors and MRF tip floors. It's just a place for the trucks to come in, either primary or secondary vehicles, and drop the waste off. What's a little bit special about thermal treatment facilities is because it's so important for the waste to be fairly homogeneous and fit into that sector in that design diagram I was showing of the waste composition, we also at this stage have kind of a storage and mixing element. So we've got different types of waste coming. You could have ICI waste that's all kind of one type, and then curbside waste, and it might be different from different communities. So you want to homogenize as much as possible so the reaction is as easy to control and stable as possible. So after it hits the tip floor in this bunker, it'll be kind of equalized by being mixed with other waste before it's charged into the combustion chamber. Next stage is charging, so that big grapple will lift the material up and load it into the front end of the furnace, and it'll be moved down into the reaction, usually on this system of moving grates that you can see in the picture. And you can see there's some holes in the grates, which is where the aeration will be supplied. And as it moves through the grates, we'll get different things happening. So the first thing will happen is the waste will dry off because it needs to burn off the moisture before it can actually start volatilizing and burning the solids. Once it's dried enough, then it will be able to ignite, and we'll get those reactions that we saw happening in the little candle flame going on. So all the solids will first turn into flammable gases, liquids, and solids. A little bit of oxygen will move them all into flammable gases, and then even more oxygen will help them all burn out into carbon dioxide and other combustion products. And that phase where everything's burning out into those final combustion products is called burnout. And the whole point of an incineration reaction is to get as much burnout as possible. So that happens both by making sure all the solids turn into gases, and then by making sure all the gases are fully burned. And the dimensions used to control these are known as time, temperature, and turbulence. So they need enough residence time in the reactor to completely burn. They need a high enough temperature that everything's going to be able to volatilize and be burned. And we need enough turbulence that there's good mass transfer between our solid and gas states. Everything's going to be mixed up and contacted enough to completely get that 100% burnout. Here's a quick diagram of those stages as the material is being charged into the combustion chamber and what's going on as it moves through. So we've got our nice green wet waste coming in here. Then our first stage is drying as it's getting in. It's using the heat that's coming off the waste that's already burning to drive some of that water off, and that's going to go up in the flue gas. Next, we have our pyrolysis and gasification going on of that solid that's there. Once we have kind of a critical mass of flammable vapors coming off, then we'll start getting more oxidation of that material. And you can see here there's undergrate air being supplied, and that is mostly to cool the grates off, but it also is helping support some of this gasification. And then all the flammable gases that are coming off the top of that waste are going to be burned with this secondary air. So we've got air coming below to cool the grates off, and then air coming from above that it's actually going to be used to burn out all the flammable gases that are coming off the waste. Coming down to the end of the combustion chamber, by this time we've burned most of the things that are going to burn, and it's just going to be ash that was not able to burn further in the combustion chamber that's coming out the bottom, and that's going to go and be managed separately, and we'll talk about that later on. And this graph underneath here kind of shows what's going on with, in the green line, the energy potential. So through drying and pyrolysis gasification, we're kind of maintaining the energy, it's just in different forms. And then through oxidation, we have this rapid, every time a molecule is burned out into its oxidized form, we lose some of that energy forever. So that's kind of the advantage of pyrolysis and gasification. We stop the reaction here and maintain those energy storage in our pyrolysis and gasification products, whereas incineration, we keep going and we get rid of all our energy right here in our reactor. And through this, the temperature is going to be going up and up and up every time something is burned. By the time we get to the end, there's nothing left to burn, so then the temperature will be lower because there's no heat being produced anymore. In addition to the moving grate style reactor, which I showed where things kind of, they move down kind of on an escalator, like you can see in this picture, there are other types of reactors, and they're both also aimed at achieving those three T's, time, turbulence, and temperature. So a rotary drum and a fluidized bed are some other styles. Now, these are more often applied for hazardous waste that need like really good burnout, so there's no hazardous molecules making it through, or through really wet waste that need really good mass transfer to vaporize the water before they can actually burn. So like wastewater, sludge, and leachate you might use in these types of incinerators. But these are just other styles that will achieve those same things. They just work a little bit different in terms of how they achieve that turbulence step. They use the spinning motion or this fluidized bed that's constantly moving around and redistributing heat rather than the grates that are moving through the combustion chamber that's typically seen in mass burn incinerators. Our next step is energy recovery. So there's kind of two modes in mass burn systems for recovering energy. One type of system is called a refractory line system. So refractory refers to refractory brick, which is a material that's really resistant to heat. And so the reactor itself will be aligned with this brick and try and keep the heat in as much as possible. And then all the hot flue gases will be piped somewhere else and put into a boiler where the heat exchange will actually take place. The other approach is to actually have the heat exchange happen right in the reactor itself. So rather than having the boiler be the site of the heat exchange, the whole reactor is the site of the heat exchange, and that's called a water wall system. And it's called that because it has the boiler water being piped through the walls to heat up right there in the reactor. Here's what a water wall system would look like. Obviously, you can only take pictures from the inside while it's not being operated, so this is during maintenance, but you can see all these pipes along the wall. So this would be after the combustion chamber where everything burned. All the flue gas is going to be rising up through this chamber, and it's going to be contacting with these pipes and heating up the water. And then this water is going to be, it's going to be in its liquid state in the bottom, and as it carries that heat, it's going to turn into its steam state. And when we get to the top of this, we'll have all the steam that can be piped off to a steam turbine for electricity generation. And then the waste heat from that can be piped off and used for lower grade heating uses like district heating and things like that. The refractory system, so instead of having the system lined with those pipes that are going to be contacting the hot gases and pulling it into the water directly there, you can see that this system is lined with these refractory bricks. Again, this is taken during maintenance because you can't really take pictures while it's operating, but you can see all these bricks inside. This is one of the rotary drum style incinerators, so a little bit different style. And then the actual boiler where the heat will be taken out of the flue gas. So all the energy is going to come out of the combustion chamber and going to go into this boiler. And then we have all these tubes that are doing the same thing as all these tubes in the water wall. They're just in a separate boiler. But most plants tend to use the water wall system. The refractory system might be more suited to a smaller mass burn plant.